in this topic called Protocol Architectures and Internet Applications, there's in fact a mix of a few things to cover. So today we'll just cover the first part of it, which is what is a protocol architecture? And for that, we need to know what is a protocol. Okay. So we'll try and cover that today. Again, same with the other class. In the other class, what are you? IT section. The other class, CS section, computer science, IT, third year. We have people from somewhere else, from overseas, exchange students. Where are you from? All four of you from France. Okay, so we have some exchange students here for this course and some of our other courses, so you'll get to meet them. When you meet them in Thai, what do you say when you first meet someone in Thai? Say, in English, I would say hello. Okay, you would hear that many times. Sawati, sawati, krap for a man. I'm not good at it. And what about in French? Bonjour. Okay, so there you go. You've learned something to how to meet people. What about in France, if you go to an interview or a business meeting and you formally greet someone, what do? You shake their hands. So you put your hand out, the other person puts their hand out and they shake hands. Okay? Same in Thai? Shake hands? Why shake hands? In Thai, there's a different greeting, a different formal greeting to why. Okay? And I don't understand the details. But they understand even less, so let's explain to them, or you'll explain to me and them, how to why, okay? And so that we have a record, and I know what you're going to do, I'm going to record and write down the instructions. So you tell me how it works. What is a why? And tell them as well. What is a why, okay? How to show respect to someone. When do you do it? When you meet people. So when you say two people come together, let's keep it simple, two together. A thank you as well when you're leaving or saying thank you. Okay, so it's used for different reasons to communicate. One of them is, say, simple case. Two people come together and they want to greet each other. Okay. So we say it in France and in Western, it's a handshake. Here in Thailand, we have the why. Let me write down the rules for what we do when two people come together. So we'll see, it's a form of communications. And the reason we're doing this is we'll see that it's actually a protocol for communications. And we'll see what is a protocol by going through this. Let's say, I'm the person and someone else comes in. There's two people, both enter the room. They need to greet each other so that at the start, what happens? What do I do? In English, you may say hello. No, in Thailand, what do we do? What do I do? Give me some instructions for what to do in this formal greeting of using a why. Put hands together, okay, like this. Okay, like this. So there's the format for how you communicate this why to someone else. So you put your hands together. We'll come back to that exactly how to do it in a moment. Who puts their hands together? Both people at the same time? Two people come into the room. They want to greet each other. Do both of the people at the same time put their hands together like this? Older people do what? So something about age. Who does it first then? The younger person initiates. So let's write this down. So from my perspective, and I'll write these rules from one person's perspective, if let's say a younger person or someone junior to me, okay, younger than me, if a junior person arrives, then what do I do? So imagine I'm here. If a junior person is the one that arrives, what do I do? I wait for a why, okay? Because it's the junior person that should initiate this communications. Okay, so there's the first rule. And I'll a bit later we'll describe what happens when we are in this state of waiting for a why. Okay, so think of that as some state that we're in. Initially, I'm in the start state. Someone arrives. If they're junior, I'm going to go into this state of waiting for them to do something. What if they were senior? If they're not junior, if it's a senior person that arrives, what do I do? Why? Okay. I initiate the communications. So I send a message to them. So let's say even better, I send a message, and this message is called a why. We'll describe the format of this message shortly. Okay, so we're just writing the rules so people can follow and communicate well. Else, well, I'm going to keep it simple. I've said if junior person arrives, else means otherwise they're senior. What if they're both the same age? We won't consider that. That's too hard, okay? Let's keep it simple. Either someone's junior to you or senior to you. Senior being older. After I send the why to the older person, what do I do? So I've done the why to the older person. What do I do now? Okay, I say sawadee to them. I'm going to save space and not write everything down. Okay, and then what do? Start talking. Always the case. So I wire someone else and then I just start talking. Sometimes they should respond to me, correct? Not always, but sometimes it's a two-way greeting. One person, the junior person, gives a why to the senior person. The senior person may respond. Okay, so let's consider that case. And again, I'm keeping it simple and only some cases. So I wait for a response because they should do the same to me. Okay, and then what happens? So let's now consider we're in this state of waiting for a response, and let's consider if I receive a why from a junior person, so what do I do? If a junior person arrives, then I wait, and then if I receive the why from the junior person, what do? Then I can why them. And then what? Start talking. Okay, talking. A simple set of steps that junior person arrives, I wait for them to initiate the communications. If they initiate, I respond, and then we've finished this greeting and we start our data communications. We start talking. Okay, that's a simple description. Of course, what about this case? What do we do? Why? What happens now? Start talking, okay? Because this is a case where I send a why to the senior person, I wait. If they send one back to me, then this greeting is finished. And then we start talking. Okay, so if I could type that, I'd be happy. This is a protocol. This is a protocol for greeting people in Thailand. It's for two entities to communicate with each other to do a specific purpose. This is just greeting. How to talk to people, well, there's another protocol for that. That is, one person talks first, the other person then responds. If two people talk at the same time, usually the conversation is not much fun. Okay, so the talking phase requires a different protocol. So this is a protocol for greeting, and you can see we can describe it as a set of states that we may be in. In the start state, I do something. In the waiting state, I do something different. Some events that arrive. Some person arrives. Someone sends me a message. I receive a message. And some actions that I take. I go into the wait state. I send a message. I start talking. So this is a very simple example of a protocol. When my laptop wants to send a file to this PC, if they're connected via some transmission line, then they both need to follow the same protocol to be able to communicate. So another way to think of a protocol is as a language. Two people or two entities, for them to communicate, they both must speak the same language. They both must use the same protocol. If I follow the protocol of a handshake and someone else follows the protocol of the Y and we try to greet each other, it will not work very well. Okay? As humans, we can adjust. Okay, if I go to shake someone's hand and they do something else to me, then maybe I'll respond. But with computers, if they speak the wrong protocol, they just won't be able to communicate. Nothing will work. So, just a quick example of a protocol in this case. Any other statements we need here? All right. What if how long do I wait? Junior person arrives. And we're just both standing there. Junior person walks in, and we're both standing there. I'm waiting for them to why me. They're younger than me. How long do I wait? 20 minutes? Okay, and still they start the conversation. What do I do then? They didn't why me. What do? Complain? At least I have a feeling of maybe less respect from them towards me. Maybe I'll just ignore them and walk away. All right, depends upon the person in that case of how they respond. But importantly, well, there are different types of events that can happen. And especially with computers, if we're sending and receiving messages between computers, things can go wrong. I send a message from my laptop to the PC. I'm expecting a response message back. I'm waiting for a response. My computer cannot wait forever. We need some timeout mechanism that says, if I don't receive a response in 100 milliseconds, then do something else. Maybe give up the communication, say there's an error. In this case, if I don't receive a response, then I will take some action. In this case, walk away or whatever. Similar, if I wait too long for the senior person, I have given a why to them, and I'm waiting for a response, then I may take a different action. So the timing of what happens is important in a protocol, especially waiting for things, timeouts. We'll see them as we go through protocols this semester. We'll see on the slides. A protocol describes a set of rules that entities follow in order to communicate. But it also defines the set of messages that they use. What do we send? We send a Y in this case. Think of this as our message. We receive this message. So that's the message that we send. Let's describe that. Well, in our simple case, we have just one message type. And it has some meaning. So we need to describe what the meaning is. But in fact, in a way, again, what do? Put the hands here and bow a little bit, correct? What if I put the hands here? Is that correct? No. Okay, if I do this, not correct. Okay, so there's a format or a structure of the message. It must be defined for the communications to work. Is there just one type of why, or are there multiple types? What are some different ones? Is this the same as this? Different meaning? What's the difference? The kind of people that... Okay, towards a monk, a more senior person, maybe to show more respect, you may do it maybe higher, better than just this, okay? So the where you put the hands has some meaning. That is, the messages, the structure of those messages have different meanings. So depending upon the message type, they mean something else to the receiver. So whether it's the higher one, the lower one, and the students that do to me when they're carrying their books or their laptop, the one-hand one, okay? So there's different types, and they have different types of meanings. Same when my computer sends a message to here, this PC must know the exact format of the message so that it knows when it receives message A, it knows what action to take, because it knows message A means everything's okay. When it receives message B, it may mean there's an error. So the messages that we send between computers have some meaning. So what is a protocol? A set of rules that two or more peer entities, so when two entities are communicating, we're saying they're peers with each other, set of rules that they obey in order to communicate. So we saw an example of a protocol for greeting in Thai, but there are many other things that we need protocols for. So in fact, there are two parts of a protocol: the procedures, that is those rules, those if else statements that I wrote, and the syntax or the format of the data message or data blocks, the types of messages, what do they mean? So in general, that's what we mean by a protocol. All of our data communications, the devices that communicate, in order to be successful, both devices communicating must follow the same protocol, must understand the protocol that's being used. So that's a protocol. Now, I want to communicate from laptop to PC. I want to send a file from laptop to PC. I can write some software in my computer that implements a protocol. All these if-else statements define the message types. The problem is, with data communications, all the tasks needed for that communication to be successful, there are many of them, and very complex. So, in fact, we cannot have one protocol that does everything. It's just, there's so much that we need to do to communicate, there's not just one magic protocol for everything. There's a protocol for my laptop to communicate wirelessly to the access point up there. There's a different protocol for my laptop to communicate via wires to some other device, and so on. So, we don't just have one protocol, we have many different protocols. And that will lead us to the need for a protocol architecture. Because data communications is very complex, there are many tasks, what we do is we apply this divide and conquer principle. Take one hard task, divide it into many subtasks, and try to conquer, solve those individual subtasks separately such that we solve the larger task. That's the concept here. In communications, the task of communicating between computers, we divide into subtasks and we organize those subtasks some way. And the way that we organize them is into layers. That is, think of a layered stack. At the bottom layer, there are protocols responsible for some tasks. At the next layer, there's protocols responsible for different tasks, and so on. Such that if we combine all of those layers, all of those protocols, we'll be able to successfully communicate between computers. The collection of the layers together and the protocols inside those layers we refer to as a protocol architecture. And that's what we'll try and describe today in the rest of this lecture. We'll go back and forth between some of these slides. So I'll go forward a few to just give you a quick example. Here is a protocol architecture. Very simple view. It is called the TCP/IP protocol architecture, and it's what we're going to use in this course. And I've drawn it as five layers and some names for those five layers. In fact, we'll use this throughout the course. You'll need to memorize this. The physical layer, data link, network, transport, application. The idea is that my laptop, to communicate with other devices on the internet, implements inside my laptop these protocols in these five layers. So my laptop has some protocol inside which we consider as part of the physical layer. Another protocol or protocols, there may be one or more, as part of the data link layer, network layer protocols, transport layer protocols, and application layer protocols. And when, for example, I want to access a website, I open up Firefox, I type in a URL, and I press enter, then the communication software in my laptop, software and hardware, goes to work, and it follows these layers in that there's a protocol for accessing a web server, that is for web browsing. What's the name of the protocol for web browsing? HTTP, it's up here. So HTTP is a protocol. It supports the application of web browsing. It doesn't matter what your web browser is, Firefox, IE, Safari, some mobile browser. They all use HTTP. They all use the protocol called the Hypertext Transfer Protocol because that's built for web browsing. But it doesn't do everything that my computer needs to get data to the web server and get a response, a web page back. Because the tasks for communicating, as we say, are split into different layers. It does some things for the communications, and then other protocols in the other layers do other tasks, perform other tasks. So HTTP does something, if I want to access a website, and then sends some data to the transport layer protocol. And there are different transport layer protocols. The one that HTTP uses is, in fact, TCP. We don't need to know that yet, but that's just this example. That is, HTTP allows me to access a web server. But to get that information reliably to the web server without any errors, HTTP will not handle that for me. It leaves it to another protocol called TCP. So TCP performs some tasks, specifically providing some reliability. If something goes wrong, TCP tries to fix that. Instead of HTTP having to provide reliability, it leaves it to someone else to do. So we share the tasks amongst the different protocols. TCP is used. In the network layer, a different protocol is used. Also, in this case, IP is the main one, the Internet Protocol. Its main task is to get data from my computer across the Internet to the server. And we'll see some more examples of that later. To get data across the first link, okay, my computer has a wireless link to this access point. That access point has a cable going up in the ceiling down to, I think, the third floor. There's a device in there that the cable plugs into. There's another cable going to another device. And there's more cables and wireless links that eventually go to a web server in the US, some Google web server. The network layer is about getting data from my computer to the Google web server via these intermediate devices. The data link layer and the physical layer have the tasks of getting my data just across the first link, just from laptop to this wireless access point. So we'll describe them again, but the data link layer is about getting data across a single link. Again, some reliability mechanisms and a few other mechanisms. Physical layer is about getting data as bits, zeros and ones, across a link by sending some signal, some electrical signal, some radio signal in the case of wireless. So this is an example of a protocol architecture. It's divided into five layers, and they have some names, and each layer is generally responsible for a certain set of tasks. And we'll describe those tasks a bit more shortly. So go back. So that TCP/IP is a real protocol architecture. What about a simple protocol architecture? Do we need this? I think you're all smart enough that we can go straight to the real one instead of the simple fake one. We'll maybe go through a little bit of the simple one. So remember a protocol, a set of rules that our computers follow to communicate. And remember that we can't implement everything in one protocol. We need many different protocols to do different things. And the way that we make use of the different protocols is that we order them in some layers. One layer protocol uses the lower layer, which uses the one below that, and so on. And I said at the start that this is one of the hardest lectures because these concepts are hard to connect with what you already know. Let me just see if we can avoid this. Let's try this example. So here's, instead of the five-layer protocol architecture that's the real one, to start simple, let's use a fake one which has just three layers, just to keep it a little bit simpler. What that means is that for each computer, computers A, B, and C in this simple example network, each computer implements protocols in these three, grouped into these three layers. And the groupings are done by the tasks that they perform have different purposes. That is, the application layer protocols perform tasks specific to applications. What are some applications that you use in the internet or in networks? Give me some examples of types of applications. Not the actual software, but the general types of applications. What do you use every day? What internet application or type of application? Web browsing. Browsing. That's it. Web browsing is a type of application. Of course, there's different software for a web browser, and there's different software for web servers, but together when they communicate, we just say that's web browsing, the web browsing application. What protocol is used for web browsing? We've said HTTP. So this is the application type. This is the actual protocol used. More applications. Email. Okay, what's FTP used for? How do you describe it? File transfer. You want to, not so much browsing, but you want to download or transfer a large file from one computer to another some of you may not do it so much now, you can use web browsing, but FTP is a protocol for transferring files between computers. Another one? Email. All right. Everyone sends emails. I know you can use web browsers to send emails, but you can also have standalone clients that do it. And in fact, the web browser acts as a client on your behalf. What protocol or protocols does email use? There are different ones, and you may not, some of you may not have seen them because email, you don't see the name so often. SMTP is one that's used. IMAP is one that's used. POP, I will not explain them, the main ones. You'll see some of these examples on some later slides. There's no need to copy that. Anything else? Internet applications? Remote connection, BitTorrent, voice over IP, Skype type, voice calls, video calls, instant messaging, sending instant messages. Games, games we use over the network, database applications, businesses have their own proprietary applications. There are many types of applications that use the internet to perform their tasks. I won't list them all. That'll do because I can't think of all the other protocols. But there are others, okay? There are other types of applications and they have their own protocol. We classify these all part of the application layer. Okay. All of these protocols are grouped into the application layer because all of the protocols are designed to support specific applications. If I want to web browse, I use HTTP. If I want to send an email, I use SMTP and others. They're different. Because they have different goals. So, in our protocol architecture, at the application, the topmost layer, we have application protocols. Now, consider these three. Remember yesterday we introduced the accuracy as a measure of effective communications. I need to deliver an accurate representation of my data to the destination. If it's not accurate, that's no good. What level of accuracy do we need in these three? If I have a web page that's transferred from the server to my browser, does the page that my browser receives have to be identical, the same number of bytes, the exact same bytes as what the server sent? It should be. The server has a web page to send me, 1,000 bytes, has some text in it. If it sends me across the internet and my browser receives 900 bytes, of course I'm not receiving the whole web page. We want to see the exact same web page that the server has. For web browsing, we need 100% reliability. What about, and we had the example yesterday, I send an email, I love you, and if it's not received or if it's received in error at the receiver, that's ineffective. With email, what we receive should be the same as what we send. We need 100% reliability. Same with file transfer. I download a file, then if that file is incomplete or corrupt, then that's ineffective communications. What if I do download a file and I notice that it's corrupt? The software tells me that this file you've downloaded, there's some strange characters in it, it's done some detection of errors and finds it's not the correct file. What do you do? You try again. Okay, so you download a file, 10 gigabytes, you're waiting all day to get it, you get it, and then you open it up and it says, no, this file cannot play, it's corrupt. Not so good. All right, so you go back to the same place and download it again. Waste your time. But that concept of if there's an error, retry or get the sender to retransmit the data. This is a common concept used for reliability. Okay? So many protocols implement this to provide reliability. Send some data, check if it's correct. If so, send some more. If not, send the old one again. Retry or retransmit. All of these applications need such functionality, because in all of them we need 100% reliability. So one option is within HTTP, implement some retransmission scheme. And in FTP, implement a retransmission scheme. And in SMTP, implement a retransmission scheme. But in fact, they all require this same retransmission scheme. So let's make our life easier and have a different protocol that implements the retransmission, this reliability feature, and let these use that so they don't have to implement it themselves. And in fact, that's one of the roles of the transport layer. And the protocol that does it in real life is TCP. So what happens is that HTTP is just for web browsing, for this reliability, this retransmission, so that you don't have to reload the web page, but the protocols will do it automatic. It uses TCP, because TCP provides this retransmission scheme. And so does FTP. It uses TCP. And SMTP uses TCP. Okay? So this is this concept of dividing the tasks amongst different protocols and amongst different layers. So the application layer protocols focus just on the tasks for applications. Transport layer protocols, one of their roles is to focus on retransmission of data so that others don't have to deal with it. There are other protocols as well here. TCP is the main one. So in our example here, we say there are application layer protocols, transport layer protocols, and the third one is just network access. For simplicity, let's say this does everything else that we need to communicate across this simple network, including it gives addresses to these three computers. What's the address of this computer? Tell me its address. Or a nice name for its address in this network. Have an attempt. Try and give it an address, or give each of those three computers an address. A name that uniquely identifies them in the network. Keep it simple. It's on the screen. What would you call this computer? It's written there. Read it. What is this computer? Computer A. So let's call it address A. Okay? Nothing complex here. So we need some addressing scheme. So in this case, in this unrealistic case, we could say that the addressing scheme, every computer gets a letter. Okay? A, B, and C. Not very useful, because we can only have 26 computers if we limited to one, the same case. But there's some structure of the address, in this case a letter, and they're unique amongst the computers. So the role of the network access layer protocols may be defining these addresses, defining the structure, making sure each one gets a unique address, and other things for sending across the link, like generating signals to send across the link. That's some of the roles of network access. So when, maybe the next slide. If computer A wants to send some data to computer B, it needs to know the address of computer B, which is B, and it creates a message to send. And as we see in the next slide, we can think, here's the computer, here's a link into the computer, a cable plugged in. The way that we use the layers is that the user, the human user sitting at the computer, generates some data, which, let's say, the web browsing application, there's some data that comes from it that needs to be sent to B. sends that data to the transport layer protocol, for example, TCP. TCP does some things. We will not describe what it does yet, but it does some things to make sure that there's no errors, and then sends all of that to the network access layer protocol, which may do its own tasks, and then sends all of that information, the data, and we've attached some extra information, in particular some addresses. Here we attach this data comes from computer A and it's going to computer B. It's common in protocol messages that we say where it's going to and who it's coming from. Why do we need to know who it's coming from? Computer A knows it's coming from itself. Why does it say it's from A? Because the other computer may want to respond. Of course, we need to say it's to B, so when it goes into the network, it doesn't go to C. It needs to go to B. And when B receives it, it sees, oh, it was from A. I can send back a response to A if I need to send a response. So we usually include a from and a to address in the messages. For now, ignore the from and to, one and two. That's an address as well, but for a different purpose. We send a message across a link. How do we do that? Well, a message is really a sequence of bits, and the network access layer converts those bits into, say, some electrical signal and generates some electricity that goes across the wires. One way to do that conversion is when we have a bit one, generate some high voltage signal. And when we have a bit zero, generate some low voltage signal for a period of time. So that's a way to convert bits, the data, into signals. It goes through our network, it arrives at B. B notices, okay, this is to me, I'm B. Takes this, sends it to the transport layer, takes the data, sends it to the application, and now the application has received the data. If anything went wrong, the data was incorrect, it would have been the role of the transport layer to say, please send again. Something went wrong. So that's what the transport layer may do here. In this case, nothing went wrong. Okay. In the next 10 minutes, let's just... go back to our real protocol architecture, the TCP/IP protocol architecture, and then we'll move on to something else. The quiz, for example. Protocols, rules for communicating, combine multiple protocols together to communicate between computers where they are layered. They're organized into some layers. And combine those set of layers are called a protocol architecture. The main protocol architecture in use today, used in the internet, is called either the Internet Protocol Architecture or maybe more commonly the TCP/IP Protocol Architecture, named after the two main protocols, at least in the past, that are part of it. And it's here. This is what we're going to use in this course. What we're going to do in this course is describe different protocols and mechanisms as part of the physical layer, how to transmit signals, some mechanisms as part of the data link layer, how to get bits across a link efficiently, the network layer, the main one being the Internet Protocol. So after the mid-semester exam, we'll look at the Internet Protocol. And the last few lectures will finish on the transport and the application layer protocols. So we're going to go through this protocol architecture. That's why at the end of the semester, even if some things are a bit confusing now, this protocol architecture will come together and make hopefully sense to everyone. And the way that the layers combine together will make more sense. What do the layers do? I think we've said for most of them. application layer deals with application specific things. So what I'm about to say is on the next few, these two slides, which gives a brief description of those five layers. We'll go through here. Physical layer at the bottom is provides some physical interface between the device, the computer, and the transmission medium. So in my computer I have a LAN card. It's inbuilt. It's on the motherboard. Here's an old one from 15 years ago. Okay, it's just an old LAN card. Where you have the socket, you plug your cable in, and of course the cable goes to another LAN card on another computer or on a switch, another device. So the physical layer defines how we connect from the hardware here to the transmission medium. So the physical interface. What type of signals do we send out of here onto these copper wires? What those signals mean? How fast do we send those signals? The data rate. In this case, the device can send at 100 million bits per second, 100 megabits per second. It's limited to that, and that limitation is imposed by the physical layer protocol. Other protocols, like Wi-Fi, have a different physical layer, and they have other limitations. So the physical layer specifies these things about how fast the data can be transmitted, the frequencies used for the transmissions, codecs, modems, some things part of the physical layer. We'll spend three or four lectures or topics going through these things. If you don't know what a codec is, that's okay. Or a modem. The data link layer, you think the physical layer takes bits, zeros and ones, and sends signals. It doesn't really care whether the signals get to the other end or not. It's the role of the data link layer to make sure that that data sent across the link gets to the other end in a reliable manner and efficiently. And so the data link layer may provide reliability and other features that make sure that the performance is good. And we'll only see that once we get to an example in later lectures. It may also provide addresses. This device, if you looked or plugged into a computer, if it still worked, has an address. The manufacturer allocated an address to it. The format of that address we can think of as part of the data link layer, the structure of the address. A MAC address you may have heard of. I'm going through this five-layer TCP/IP protocol architecture. Other people give the layers different names. I've used data link layer. Some people call it network access. Some call it MAC, link, or even hardware layer. So we'll use data link layer in this class. Just go back one. I know you're flicking between slides. This diagram shows three devices. One's called the source host, one's the destination host, and this intermediate device, a router. Here they are. Source host is my laptop. Intermediate device is this router. A wireless router, in fact. It's got wireless capabilities, here's the antennas, and it's got some sockets on the back to plug LAN cables into. And the destination host is this PC. Of course, it's not on, but we'll pretend it is. And I unplug that one. And if everything was on, plug it in. And let's say I want to communicate now laptop to PC. So the network is laptop will connect wirelessly to this device, this intermediate device. This device will then send a signal across the copper wires to the PC. So first we have a radio signal and then an electrical signal. So the three devices here. This diagram shows the typical setup of the layers implemented in each of these three devices. The end goal is to get data from my source host to destination host, between an application on my laptop to an application on the PC. That's what I want to achieve. To do that, I use on each of those computers an application layer protocol, the same one. For example, HTTP. Maybe that's a web server. This is has a web browser. So they must speak the same language to communicate. That is, the protocol used here is the same or is supported by the protocol used here at the application layer. To make sure that the data sent across this network is sent reliably, we'll use a transport layer protocol, both here and here, the same. For example, TCP. So inside my laptop, there is an implementation of an application layer protocol, like Firefox has HTTP. My operating system has the implementation of TCP. So it's inside the OS, and the same in this computer. Now we'll skip the network and go to the bottom. Look at the link from my laptop to the intermediate device. There's no cable, it's actually a wireless link, but we still call it a link. Here it's drawn as a black line. The physical layer inside my laptop determines how to send wireless signals from a laptop to here. What frequency, what power to transmit at, the characteristics of those signals are determined by the physical layer. The wireless LAN physical layer. The physical layer used by my laptop is the same as used by the intermediate device here. And that's shown on this diagram. These two are the same, speak the same language. Same with the data link layer. The data link layer of my laptop is the same as what's used on that intermediate device, the router. They must be the same to be able to communicate. But there's a second link. The second link from this router to the PC, the physical layer used here and also the data link layer may be different from what's used here. And in fact, they are in our case. In my case, it's Wi-Fi, a wireless LAN, across the first link that has some protocols for physical and data link. And then across the second link is a wired LAN called Ethernet is the protocol used. So remember, physical and data link layers apply across links normally. They determine how to get data across one link. But in real cases, in a network, we have multiple links. It's the role of the network layer to get data across those multiple links, across a network. So my laptop has a network layer protocol. The PC has a network layer protocol, which is the same as my laptop. And also this intermediate device, the router, has a network layer protocol, which is the same as my laptop and PC. They all speak the same language at the network layer. Anyone know what that language is? What the network layer protocol is? It's IP. In the internet, the main protocol is the internet protocol. That's part of the network layer. It's for communicating across multiple different links. So this is a common setup. In the end-user computers, we have all five layers. In intermediate devices, we may not have all five layers. We don't need an application layer protocol at the router. It doesn't care that we're using web browsing. It's just data to be received and sent across link two. And when then something comes back, it's received at this router and then sent back across link one. It doesn't care if it's web browsing, email, it's just data from its perspective. that's a lot of information and a lot of new concepts that lead to a lot of blank faces. At least not many people are sleeping like in the morning section. Any questions? I assume there'll be a few, but may not receive them. Let's summarize the very basics that you need to know. Even if you don't understand everything and how it all comes together, know what a protocol is. A set of rules for entities to communicate. That we cannot just have one protocol. We need multiple protocols to do different things. And the way in communications that we organize those multiple protocols is into layers. One layer contains protocols for responsibility, has the responsibility for specific applications, the application layer we call it. One layer, the physical layer, has the responsibility of performing tasks of getting signals across links to represent the bits. Data link layer has the role of making sure that data just across the link is delivered efficiently and correctly. Just across the link. Transport layer has many tasks, but one of them is to get data efficiently and correctly across a network from one computer to the other one in the internet. Network layer has the task of just getting the data across the network to the right destination. Remember, the first measure of effective data communications was delivery. I have data. I want to deliver it to this destination host. One role of the network layer is to make sure it will take the right path through the internet to reach the destination. This is simple. There's no choice. You go here, then there. But now imagine the internet. There's connections everywhere. I want to get data from here to a web server in the US. Which path does it take? Well, solving that problem is part of the network layer. If you can capture those concepts, then I think you're going to be okay for so far. Definitely try to remember these five layers, the ordering of them and the names. There's always a question in a quiz or an exam about them. And over time, so try and remember their purposes. Some are described here, but not in much detail. Over time, you'll get a clearer knowledge of what they do. And over time, you'll start to be able to link different protocols to the different layers. HTTP is an application layer protocol. TCP is a transport layer protocol. IP network. Wi-Fi, wireless LAN is, in fact, has protocols at both data link and physical layer. So does Ethernet, twisted pair or optical fiber. The cable types really correspond to the physical layer. A couple more minutes and then we'll stop this and talk about the quiz. Where did this protocol architecture come from? Well, where did the internet come from? I mentioned briefly yesterday that in the US there was a research network called ARPANET. Connected some universities and some government organizations in the US, and it grew. More people connected, other countries connected together, connected their networks, and it grew into the internet today, okay, with all countries connected, many different users. So it grew into the internet. The two main protocols used originally were TCP and IP, and they are still used. And that's why we get this name, the TCP/IP. Well, we'll call it the protocol architecture. That's just where the name comes from. The organizations that define how TCP and IP work, we'll talk about next week. But importantly, the TCP/IP protocol architecture, here I say five layers, here are their names. There's no one document or standard that says these are the five layers. It's just decided by different people that, okay, this is a good representation of how it works. If you look in different textbooks, you may see different names. And you may see different numbers of layers. 6 or 4 you may see in different textbooks. So there's no standard way to define this. The TCP/IP protocol architecture for this course are these 5 layers. There are other protocol architectures. This is not the only one, or has not been the only one. One of the main ones in the 70s was called the Open Systems Interconnection Protocol Architecture, OSI. Had 7 layers. Similar, but there was an extra two layers in between here. Okay, there were 7 layers. It's interesting to know how it worked and the history of it, but for us, basically, at around the same time, people were developing TCP/IP, others OSI. TCP/IP was the most popular and won in terms of it was deployed the most. OSI became less and less popular and sort of died off. So it's not used in practice today, but some of the concepts of it you'll still see in textbooks, in websites. They'll refer to the OSI 7-layer model, but we will not cover it in any detail. And just to finish, there are even others. Some older ones, IBM had a protocol architecture, Apple, Novell had their own, but again, TCP/IP became the standard. Most people use that, so people started to switch from the old ones to TCP/IP. In some telephone networks, there are protocol architectures. In mobile phone networks, 3G, 4G, there are protocol architectures which are different from TCP/IP. Again, we're not going to cover them in this course. We're going to cover the most popular one. And next week, we'll continue on the rest of this topic. Okay? 15 minutes. Let's talk about the quiz and the practice lessons. Quiz opens at 12 o'clock today, so we mentioned yesterday. It's online. It opens at noon today, so directly in 15 minutes. And it closes Monday at noon, okay, Monday 12. So you have 5 days to complete the quiz. How many minutes does the quiz run for? 10 minutes, this one. Some may be longer, but you will see on the web page, but 10 is typical. How do you pass this quiz? You get 50% or higher. There are 7 questions in this one, so you need 4 or more, correct? How many attempts do you get? 3. Okay, everyone knows, fine. So if you don't get 50% in the first attempt, go back and study a bit more and try again. You get 3 attempts in total. So do the quiz, get more than 50%, and if you do that for all quizzes in the semester, you'll get the full 15%. But there's more. Sorry. Sometimes I'll also create what I'll call practice questions or practice lessons. These are not marked, the practice ones. They're not marked. They're just for you to learn or to refresh your memory on some topic or practice some topic. So if you don't do them, it won't affect your grade directly. Of course, if you do them, you may learn more and the quizzes may be easier and the exams may be easier. But these 2 practice lessons that are there, I think they're there for the next 3 weeks at least, so you can do them almost any time in the next few weeks. Units and prefixes is about, I think you have this handout. Units and prefixes, well, it's just a summary of the common units we see in this course. What's a unit? Well, seconds, meters, bits, hertz, radians or degrees, watts. They are the common units we see. There are many questions later that, okay, what is the speed of this? And people will say 100. But you must give the correct unit, 100 bits per second or 100 watts. It has a completely different meaning. So just refresh your memory on what the units are. I think this is obvious for most people. What about prefixes? Well, when we deal with very large or very small numbers, to make things more convenient, we use kilo, mega, giga, tera, milli, micro, nano, and pico for smaller numbers. Okay, so we use these prefixes to make the writing of the numbers easier. You must remember them. Okay, I'm not going to teach them. If you don't remember them, go through the practice lesson and it'll give a little bit of a description of these. Okay? So you must remember that mega is 10 to the power of 6. Nano is 10 to the power of minus 9. Okay? There are others, of course, but in this course, those 8 are the main ones that we'll see. I think we will not see any others. Sorry. So the practice lesson, they may differ. You start the lesson, there's no time limit. You can do it at any time over any period. And it gives some description of what you should do there. You can read through. And just follow next. Follow it describes those units. So if you know them already, you browse through here. It gives some summary of what you should know. If you understand units already, then you click on this link and you'll get some questions about those units to see if you do understand them. If you don't, in this case, you want to hear more, then I have a short video that gives some more examples of those units. So you can spend 5 minutes watching the video here and then go next and just answer a few questions. Again, not marked, but if you answer them correctly, you can proceed to the next part of the lesson. What's the answer? What is the symbol of the unit used to measure information? The symbol of the unit. Or what is the unit used to measure information? Bits. So information, we usually measure in bits. A bit, multiple bits. And the symbol we use is a lowercase b. Okay. And you just submit your answer, and okay, give some description. Yes, a lowercase b is used as the symbol, and allow you to continue. And in this case, not always, but in this case, you get another question. You download. Zoom in. You download 10,000 bits of data in a duration of 20 seconds. What is the average rate of the data transfer? Okay. So some people look a bit confused, but really it's the same as you've done in high school physics or maths. Of, okay, you drive 100 kilometers and it takes you 2 hours to drive that distance. How fast did you drive on average? Okay. How many kilometers per hour? So a few simple questions like that, and then once you get them correct, you proceed on to some other topic. Where do we go to? The second practice lesson is on exponentiation and logarithms. 10 to the power of 6 exponentiation, log based 2 of 32, what is it? Okay. In later topics, we'll use exponentiation, exponents, and logarithms a little bit, but nothing more than high school maths. Okay. So refresh your memory, and then you'll be fine. Okay. Exponentiation, okay, just a few properties. Some useful ones, not so much. You can use a calculator in this class, that's okay. But sometimes it's much easier to do it in your head or to confirm that what you're doing is correct. And this lesson will give you some help in that. It gives some examples of remembering, for example, what is the log base 2 of 1,000? Okay. Some ways to approximate that. What is the log in base 2 of 1,000,000? And so on. So, because we'll start to use base 2 because we deal with bits it will come up in some of our court and some of our topics. Enough talking for me. Any questions? Don't see or hear many questions.
Assignments and homework, how does that work?
So the assessment items, the quiz, 15%, these online quizzes. Homework, well, there's no assessed homework. For example, you think of these practice lessons as homework, but they don't count directly towards your grade. There'll be one assignment released around midterm, a bit before midterm, and run for several weeks after midterm, which will be a group assignment to write a report on some topic, do some experiments, and then rest are exams. Okay, so in terms of assessment, quizzes, one assignment and two exams. Any other homework type things will come up on the website, like these practice. Okay, let's finish for today, and next week we'll continue on protocol architectures, and you'll see, or you'll do your quiz before Monday, 12 noon, okay? If anyone wants to change their passwords or set their password, they can come and see me now.